Hi, and welcome to class two. I'm Christine Coral, and today we're going to continue on with the anxiety class, and we're going to focus on learning how to challenge different worries today. So we're going to start with some of the worries that are common among people who have anxiety disorders or just worry a lot. You don't have to have a disorder. And we're going to take a look at some of those common worries and challenge them, and then we're going to spend a little bit of time near the end on how to challenge your own worries. So this is what we're going to do on this class, and let's get started. So if you remember from the first class, I talked a little bit about some of the worries that are common among worriers, and you can see a long list of them. We're going to go through a few of them today. There's some negative beliefs about worrying and positive beliefs about worrying that keep worrying going. That is, those beliefs, when you have these thoughts and you believe them, you believe, you know, either worrying is harmful or helpful. Odd that, you know, these opposite ways of looking at things actually keep worrying going. And most of us who worry have both of these kinds of beliefs. When we have them, it keeps us stuck. So that's why we want to kind of deal with them. So let's dive right in. So the first worry that we're going to start with is this belief that worry is uncontrollable. Okay, so when we have that thought, and most people who come to see me in my office do have this thought. They think that, you know, there's nothing that I can do. I'm plagued with these thoughts. They never let me go. I can't shut my brain off. And what we're going to do is challenge that belief that worry is uncontrollable, because actually probably even now you're able to control it more than you think, not paying attention to some of the times where you have to put it off. So what we do when we challenge a thought is quite simply, we look at the evidence for and against that thought. So we have the evidence for in one column, and the evidence against in the next column. All right, so if we were to go through this, you know, usually I ask another person, well, what are some of the reasons why you believe that you can't control your worrying? And some of the answers that I hear a lot of the time, well, you know, I can't stop it. I do it all the time. So those are pretty common, even that it keeps me up at night. Now, I don't know what it is about worries at night, but they seem to take on a life of their own. You know, most of us have spent the night worrying ourselves crazy, and in the morning we're like, well, that was silly. Why was I worrying so much about it? And a lot of people find too, the worrying is worse when I try and stop. So if you're doing this along with me, one thing you can do is check and see if there's any other things that you could add to this list, any things that sort of contribute to your strengthen your belief that, you know, worrying is uncontrollable, because it certainly does feel that way. So now let's jump to the other column and look at some of the ways that we might have a little bit more control than we think. So, you know, often most of us have had the experience, you know, sometimes I forget to worry when I'm busy. Such a slow writer. And when we go through that, we see that, well, there's lots of times where, you know, we just don't have time to worry. We're busy trying to get a project done, or we're chasing after kids, or busy on the phone, or there's just too much going on. So there really isn't any time to worry too much about it. And so you notice when you're focused on something else, there's less bandwidth left over in your brain to worry. So that's certainly one of the ways you're going to see. It's one of the things that we can do to try and refocus our attention on things that are more productive, rather than focusing on going through and ruminating over and over again. This is going to be awful. This is going to be terrible. This is going to be catastrophic. So the other thing that we notice is eventually worrying stops on its own. You know, we just stop worrying about something. The problem hasn't been solved or gone away, but But we kind of move on and go, oh, well, you know, things I used to worry about when I was a teenager, I don't worry about anymore. Or things that I used to worry about when I was in school, I don't worry about now. And maybe I have new worries. You know, so take a look and see some of the things that you used to worry about that maybe don't bother you quite so much. And you'll see some of those things, some of those possibilities, like potential catastrophes that you used to worry about are still potential catastrophes, but they don't bother you as much. So I'm sure if you go back in your memory banks and check, you can find some of those instances. Those are some of the other things. You know, mostly it's, refocusing on something fun can stop the worrying. And those sorts of things give us a little bit more control over what we do with our minds. So really, worrying is the thoughts that we have, the things that sort of keep us busy and help us to, it keeps us busy and we can fill our brains with something else. I guess that's basically what I'm trying to say, that if we find something more interesting to think about than the worrying. It has to be engaging, though. I usually tell people that, you know, it works better when you find something that you can't stop thinking about, you know. Like, so, you know, if you really like knitting, that's going to take your mind off your worries better than playing puzzles, but, you know, vice versa for some people. So there's no one good thing. I find, you know, things like drawing good because I can't really think when I'm drawing. So you can see I can't draw when I'm talking either. It's because they're very, very different regions of the brain are involved in both of those activities. So if you do something that, you know, uses most of your brain for something else, then you're not going to have the bandwidth left over to worry. So the other thing that we kind of find is when we try to control worry, you know, last week I talked about the pink elephant, right? So we have our little elephant here. Oh, don't like that ear. Oh, my eraser's huge. There we go. Our little elephant here can be a worried elephant. And so we have our elephant here. If you don't want to think about a pink elephant, what you have to do is refocus your attention. So it's not going to help you to try and say, I'm not going to think of a pink elephant. I'm not going to think of a pink elephant. And if we treat our worries like that, then I'm not going to think about screwing up this presentation. I'm not going to think about losing my job. That doesn't work really well. We have to refocus in something else. So if you don't want to think about the pink elephant here, what you have to do is think about something else. You know, it can maybe be a blue whale. It's a really bad whale. See, I told you I can't draw and talk at the same time. But you want to replace it with something else. Let me try again without talking. Not much better, but you see what I mean. Oh, I can even make it blue here. There we go. That won't work so easily for the elephant because I don't have the layers kind of sealed off, so let me do something here. Let's make it pink. What the heck, for fun. Add a little color. Ah! Drew on the wrong layer. See, this is why I'm not drawing and talking. Some people emailed me and said, oh, you should draw more. I love your cartoons. Thank you. But now you're seeing why I don't draw and talk at the same time. There we go. Really bad coloring job, but oh well, you get the idea. So what the moral of the story here is, you have to replace your thought with something else. You have to go from the pink elephant to the blue whale or something else. So you want to refocus your attention. Better things to refocus on, I'm going to just reiterate, are fun and engaging. And mostly, I find that their activities that are nonverbal work a little bit better. When you're reading, do you ever notice that your mind can drift and you can, because you're still using the language centers of the brain, all that chatter in your brain. And so nonverbal activities, you're using very completely different regions of the brain. You're less likely to drift off in thought as you are when you're doing something like reading a story that maybe isn't completely using all of your senses. Certainly watching TV can take your mind off of it, but it's also kind of passive too. You don't have to do that much work. You know, actually video games can work a little bit better because you're engaged in that and you have to pay attention or you get killed. Or even if you're playing like a puzzle game, like Tetris can be quite good because that's a puzzle game where you have to work quickly under pressure of time. So you don't really have time to think. So I find those activities where you don't have time to think. No time to think. Will work a little bit better if you want to see if you can postpone your worrying, which is one of the things that you can practice over the next week, is postponing your worries. So what you can do is see if you can find some other activities that will take your mind off. I mean, I even do this with my kids when they're upset about something or worrying about something. I'll say, well, what can you do to take your mind off of it for now? Because there's not much that we can do about that. We don't know if that will happen. What can you do to take your mind off of it? It works too if they bump their heads or do something where they stub their toe, and we try and find things to take their minds off of it. Because that's the thing with brains, they can only do so much, so many things at one time. You know, really, we can do one thing really well, two things sort of well, and three things we're kind of finished. That's why multitasking doesn't work so well. But it's the same thing with worrying. So that's one trick I usually tell people for this exercise of postponing your worries for as long as you can. You want to take your mind off, and sometimes keeping a little diary can be helpful too. So I'm erasing layers here. Some of you who use Photoshop or other things like that, you'll know what that's doing. Oh, I didn't erase complete layers here. So let me get this elephant off the screen. So a worry diary, what you can do is just set things up, have your date, kind of like similar to the last time, the thoughts, worries here, and you know, did you postpone? And how anxious you were from 0 to 10, or 0 to 100%, whatever you prefer, either works for me. And you would just, you know, write down your date and the worry. I'm going to screw this up. And postpone, you can say, you know, played Monopoly my kids, and your anxiety might have gone down to 50. And then you can even check and see what kinds of activities seem to work better. You know, you have Monopoly, painting, video game, whatever it is. You know, and sometimes this can be an okay strategy just to see if you can control your worry and test your worry. Eventually, you don't want to have to keep busy all the time to keep the worrying going. But when we're challenging a belief and we're testing it out, we're going to use it in this instance to sort of do it, especially if it's a worry you know there's not really much that you're going to do about it. There's no real solution to the worry. It's just kind of a what if sort of thing. But once we want to challenge this belief that worry is uncontrollable, because it is. You know, there's a lot that we can do, a lot of strategies we can use to check and make sure that we can focus our attention where we want to focus our attention. The other thing is, the more we practice focusing our attention where we want it to go, the better off, the more skilled we're going to be at doing this. It gets easier to focus your attention where you want it to go the more you practice it. So it's kind of like a coping muscle sort of thing. You know, you hear me say this expression a lot of CBT therapists do. You know, we want to exercise our coping muscles. And so you're going to get better and better and better the more you practice it, focusing your attention where you want it to go. Okay, so that's our first sort of negative belief about worry. So I want you to practice over the next week and see, you know, how much control do you have this week over your worries, and can you get a little bit more control, a little bit more of your life back from the worrying by refocusing your attention somewhere else. Okay, so our next, come on, oh, wrong layer. our next belief about worry is dangerous. Actually, maybe it's even worrying. I'll put that there. The process of worrying is dangerous. And a lot of people believe this. They think that it gets our heart rate up. We feel awful. Almost feels like we're dying or going crazy. And so it must be bad for us. And that's one of the first things that we work on. You'll see, especially if you have panic attacks, this is a really key belief that goes along with panic attacks, that the worry itself, the panic itself is very dangerous. So if this is a real sticky one for you, I am going to do a panic disorder class online too. If it's not already up there later, if you're watching this a year after I've posted this, it should be up by then. So let's do this again, this idea that worrying is dangerous. So let's look at the evidence for and the evidence against. Okay, so again, you know, when we look at the evidence for, really easy to believe that it's bad for us because it feels terrible. Okay, now even though it feels terrible, it actually is pretty harmless. It's the instinct that kicks in with worry is and fear and anxiety is that we got to get out of there. Something's going to eat us, and that's why it's such a strong impulse. And it's really there to save our lives. It's there for a good reason. So that's why it does feel terrible. It's to motivate us to leave. If we didn't worry, we'd wander out in the middle of the street and walk down dark alleys and do all kinds of things. And worrying can protect us. It's when it gets overused that we want to make sure that we keep it in check. So yes, it does feel terrible. So that could be some evidence, you know, until you watch this class, that it's harmful to you. You know, most of us have heard that stress is bad for you. You know, we hear all these relationships between stress and disease and stress shortening our lives. And really, you know, long-term chronic stress, yes, you want to do something about it. But in the short term, worrying really isn't going to do that much to you. What can happen is that our heart rates do go up and we feel terrible. But some of the, see, I'm getting into the evidence against column. I can't help myself. So maybe I'll save this for the next column. But yes, definitely think this. And also, you know, there's some evidence too that stress can affect your immune system. There's certainly many studies that have looked at college students around exam time and seeing that they actually do get more colds and flus, probably because they're stressed out from studying, feeling anxious about exams, but also not sleeping well, not eating well, not taking care of themselves. So we do see reduced immune function in students around exam time. Actually, one university where I used to teach, they put a, I don't know if they still implement this is the University of Ottawa, but they had students go to the doctor from the student health center, where those doctors would know the regulations. And basically, as long as you weren't puking, you had to go write your exam. Really charming, huh? Really fun when I had to administer exams to six students. I'm just like, oh man, it's no fun. I mean, I think I would have given them a pass, but oh wow. So the evidence against is when we look at, you know, all the anxiety, you know, I'm still here. You know, lots of us worry a lot and lots of us feel stressed a lot of the time. You know, it's hard not to feel stressed at different points in your life. And, you know, in fact, life expectancy is longer than ever, you know, in any part of recorded history. So, you know, it can't be that harmful to us. What it also is, we notice is people who aren't stressed get sick too. So that's always fun when you're not stressed. You're like, oh, why did I succumb to that? And yeah, it just does. You know, that virus gets in and we can get the cold and flus just like people or just like students who get exams. So that's not the whole story. You know, the other reason why we know that stress isn't harmful is we're built to feel anxious. As I started to go on, I got excited and jumped over to it. But it protects us. It keeps us safe. It's there for a reason. And, you know, there's also a lot of other kinds of things that get adrenaline going. So other emotions create an adrenaline rush. In fact, some people pay good money for that. So, you know, namely excitement. You know, so people who dive off cliffs and take snowmobiles up the side of the mountain in my part of the world, I've seen some, they start avalanches and scary things like that, or skiing out of bounds. I'm coming up with lots of winter sports because, well, I'm Canadian, so there you go. But if people who are particularly adventurous, or, you know, surf really huge waves there, I came up with a California example. What happens is you can be very healthy, very fit, but, you know, really like that rush. And physiologically, excitement's very similar to anxiety. A lot of the body only has so many ways of reacting physiologically to different events. So excitement's very similar to anxiety and stress. The only difference is how we interpret that. But we don't really think of anxiety as being harmful to us. So, you know, there's you know, lots of people who worry in the world, who are healthy. You know, when I used to work in a cancer center, and one thing that was really annoying to some of the patients there is people will often tell them that you have to keep a positive attitude if you want to beat your cancer. And the truth is, you don't. The research really shows there's no difference between people who are upbeat and positive during their cancer treatment and people who are even struggling with depression. You know, as far as treatment outcomes go, the outcomes are actually very similar. So that surprises a lot of people, because they think that the stress and the anxiety about having cancer, I don't know how you go through cancer treatment without anxiety, will cause some catastrophic outcomes. So a lot of the people that I worked with were very relieved when we would talk about how that doesn't matter. In fact, I almost think you waste a lot more energy trying not to be nervous. It's just easier to go, okay, well, I'm nervous, here we go, and practice not caring about having that anxiety there. Notice how I say practice not caring that you're feeling anxious, because it's certainly a skill that you develop over time. But, you know, the one thing that we want to emphasize in cognitive therapy of anxiety treatment is anxiety is benign. And the more, you know, one of the reasons why we focus so much on this is the more that we try not to worry, the more we think, oh my God, I'm killing myself doing this, it's harder to let go of it. You know, it's just like when you try and fall asleep. The harder you try and fall asleep, the more likely it is you're going to be up all night. The harder you try and stay awake all night, the more likely it is you're going to fall asleep. And it's the same thing with anxiety. So it's not so much actually how much anxiety you even feel when you're anxious. It's that causes an anxiety disorder. It's even your tolerance for anxiety. And certainly what lowers our tolerance for anxiety is this notion that it's harmful. So if I were to, I draw this on the board a lot. So, you know, if we have anxiety here, high and low, and tolerance, how do I do this? So we have anxiety is up here, but, oh, here, yeah, so I'm sorry, anxiety's here. Tolerance is here. Let's graph backwards. See, this is what you do when you don't have time to rehearse. And so your tolerance is down here for it. You think it's dangerous, it's awful, I can't stand it. That's where there's suffering, right? That's where we really struggle with this. So a lot of people come to me in therapy and they want me to bring their anxiety down here, but that's actually not where we start. We have to start, you know, with this notion that, you know, it's really not going to hurt you, you know, as hard as it is. You know, in the beginning, you just practice accepting the fact that you're having trouble accepting your anxiety. What we try and do is increase your tolerance up here. And then once you get your tolerance up, what happens is there's no suffering, or reduced suffering at the very least. You know, so it's kind of like if you have a headache or a cold, it's annoying, and you take it easy on yourself. You know, so you think of anxiety as having a bit of a psychological flu. You take care of yourself, you rest, you can't do as much, but it doesn't bother you quite so much. So some of the things you use to cope with the physical symptoms of other problems, like minor colds and flus, are the same things that you bring to coping with the physical symptoms of anxiety, which are also just as benign. Even though sometimes you can feel like you're dying when you have a cold, you're actually not. So that's the kind of mindset that you want to bring. And you, when you have a cold and your nose is stuffy, then you want to do things to take your mind off of that. And that can help ease your suffering a little bit. So I hope that makes sense. So once this happens, once you reach a point where your tolerance is increased for anxiety, what can happen is that's when your anxiety starts to drop. Not before, unfortunately. If there was a magic way to increase your tolerance, it's more of a, I don't know, for me, I find it's more of a practice kind of thing. You know, gradually I'm at a point now where I don't really care. If I have a headache, if I have anxiety, it's annoying. And I'll just kind of notice it and sort of be curious about it. So those are two of the biggies as far as negative beliefs about worry. So let's move on to one of the positive beliefs about worry, that it helps me cope. And this is a biggie. And lots of people feel that anxiety does help them cope. It does help them prepare for the worst and prevent bad outcomes. So let's look at this one here. So again, you know, for each of these worries, and we're going to do this again for your individual worry. So you, if you kept the worry diary that I asked you to from the first class, then you can use some of the thoughts when we get to the next section. So evidence for, it helps me cope, and evidence against. Now it's interesting, you know, on the one hand, most of us who worry have these negative beliefs about worry, that they're harmful and they're uncontrollable. Yet on the other hand, you know, if we worry, we're responsible, it shows we care, it helps us cope, and so how do you win? You know, it's either good for you or it's not good for you. Ultimately, it's not productive, so that's why we're going to challenge some of these beliefs. So let's look at the evidence for this one, that it helps me cope. So there's this idea, it helps me prepare. And essentially, well, it helps me prepare for the worst case scenario all the time. There we go. So, and then it also, some people believe that it motivates them. I did have a friend in grad school who used to call me and ask me to motivate her. And I said, what, you haven't started studying for that? Are you crazy? There's no way that you're going to be ready. And of course, then she'd go, okay, thanks. But I still don't think she really worried. I think she just wanted to hear how much I had done. Also, some people believe it stops bad things from happening. Okay, it shows I care. I'm responsible. Can do a whole list of all these things of, you know, why it helps us cope, you know, that it's irresponsible not to do that. You know, who wouldn't worry about that? So the trouble is, a lot of the worrying that most of us do is kind of unproductive, and it's for things that are never going to happen. And if they do happen, we could probably cope anyway. So let's look at the evidence against. Well, you know, for most of us, when we're engaged in this kind of unproductive worrying and going around and around and around in circles, what's really happening is we get less done. And that's mostly because we can't concentrate. Hard to sit still. So that's kind of frustrating too, you know, and when you have a lot of energy and you can't sit still and you feel like you're going in circles, and or, you know, you're trying to study for an exam and you're worrying and worrying and worrying about this exam, you know, the worrying actually doesn't help you prepare for the exam. anxiety is really helpful when a bear is chasing you. It's not so helpful when you have to sit down and, you know, do some brain work, some thinking, and concentrating. So what we really see is anxiety is, for the most part, not that helpful in getting things done. So that's one way we're going to kind of loosen this belief that it does help me cope, because usually it makes it harder to cope, if anything, to buckle down and get done what we need to get done. The other idea is bad things usually don't happen, whether I worry or not. You know, while it's true, worst case scenarios do happen, you know, for the most part, you know, life kind of goes on easily and without too many problems that we can't cope with. I'll add that at the end. I mean, there's always busyness, there's politics at work and drama and bills. But in most of those situations, if not all of those situations, worrying isn't really going to help you. So worrying in and of itself doesn't prevent anything. It's going to happen whether it happens or not. And if something does happen, I can cope with whatever happens. I mean, okay, so one really worst case scenario would be, you know, if you were worrying, what if I had cancer, and you find out you do have a cancer diagnosis, then some of the things that you would have to do to cope would be let yourself feel anxious about it. Well, I would expect some worry, and I could look for support. I can talk to family. I can talk to friends. I can go to the cancer agency where I'm getting treatment and see what kind of resources they have to support me through that. I could take up meditation. You know, here and where I live, there's meditation classes for people who are diagnosed with cancer. And, you know, while it, you know, it really is a challenging and not fun thing to go through, you know, certainly something I went through a few years ago myself, and I can guarantee you I was not happy. but I think, you know, one thing that did make it easier for me when I was going through my own cancer treatment was that I didn't try and suck it up. I knew I didn't have to suck it up, and that I could cope with the feelings that I was having at that time, and that it wouldn't last forever. That's what I kept telling myself. So luckily I had a fairly easy course as far as that goes, and everything's good now. And then the other thing is, you know, we waste a lot of time worrying too, that, you know, there's a low probability of most of the things that I worry about . So is that really an effective use of time? You know, letting myself worry over and over and over and over and over again. So are there better ways of dealing with that? So one thing that you can see, you can do another experiment, like with the postponing worry experiment a little bit earlier, if you're still feeling a little sticky about this idea that it helps you cope. You can see you're preventing bad things from happening. So what you can do is you can keep a little time where you spend more time worrying one day and less time worrying another day, and then see, you know, does that make a difference? Do you prevent bad things from happening? Do you feel worse? So what you can do is you set a worry time on the days that you're going to worry more. So say, you know, I'm going to sit here and I'm going to deliberately worry for 30 minutes. And you go through and say, oh, it'd be awful if I had cancer. It'd be awful if I failed my exam. It'd be awful if I lost my job. And try and do that chaining that I talked about in the first experiment. And you just keep that going for 30 minutes. Kind of force yourself to do it. And see, you know, keep track. You know, are the days that you worry, does this make a difference? Does, you know, it help you cope? Or prevent bad things from happening? compared or on this on the alternate days, you can alternate days, you can do some refocusing instead. You know, play a video game or something fun instead of worrying for that 30 minutes and see if that makes a difference. And, you know, generally what you'll see is that that unproductive worry. I really emphasize that. Doesn't help. You know, there's worrying and there's problem solving. And so when you're in a situation where you've got a problem to solve, like, you know, maybe you are having a tough time with your boss and you are concerned about your job, then you have to come up with a plan. So say you're worried about your plan. Well, I'm jumping ahead a few courses to problem solving, but just to give you a little preview, then you might get your resume in order because you don't know if you're going to get laid off. You would start putting feelers out and asking friends if they know of any opportunities. You kind of have to spring into action mode. So, you know, yeah, I know lots of us do lose jobs and have that worry. And it's hard to go through life without worrying about that. I know there's like almost every hospital I worked at some point, there was some restructuring going on and everybody worried about their job. So, you know, even if you're in a fairly secure kind of job, you can end up worrying about that. So you have to come up with a plan. You know, that we don't really live in days where there's a lot of job security for most of us. So you kind of have to get creative with that. And, you know, what would you do to cope in that situation? Okay. So those are some of the basics that you kind of want to challenge. When we talk about challenging your own thoughts, whoops, kind of talked a little bit about that while we went along. I gave a few different examples, but you know, it could be any thought. What if I screw up the presentation? Okay. You can take any kind of what if thought. You can pick it off of your chart. So what you can do is, you know, just keep a little worry diary. You keep track, you know, what are the thoughts that are going through your mind. And you can do the whole chain, you know, that people will think I'm stupid. I'll lose friends. People will laugh. Get nasty emails. And so on. So you can look at that chain of thoughts. So, you know, what am I really predicting will happen? You know, so I have all these thoughts, but what's the main prediction? And I'll be rejected and alone. Okay, so you take it to sort of your worst. What do you think that would happen? What's your big fear? And then, you know, rate your feelings. So we have anxiety, might be, I don't know, 85%, sad, 70%. And, you know, a lot of times a big one is frustration, right? Because we feel like there's nothing that we can do about it. So maybe that's 99%. Okay. So what we want to do is look at the evidence for and against this prediction here. So what happens when we worry a lot of the time is we really don't take it past the point that this would be awful. When we actually sit down, write it out, look at our thoughts and test it out. And this does take practice. You know, most of us have to do this with about 100 thoughts before it really becomes sort of automatic and you don't really need to sit down and do this all the time. Usually now thoughts pop into my head and I think, oh, that's ridiculous. So what we do is really focus on practicing. And you can't come up with evidence for and against that you really don't believe, right? It has to be hit you in your gut and you have to really believe in what you're writing down. So sometimes a therapist can help you with that if you're feeling a little bit stuck with that. I know this is kind of a quick overview. or there's books that you can read that can help you with more diaries and more examples. But the more you practice this, the better you'll get. So if we look at this prediction, I'll be rejected and alone, and we try and find evidence for and against that, what we see is, you know, for, well, I've lost friends before. It's harder to meet people if you're not cool, or to keep friends if you're not cool. You may believe that. I don't believe that, but just an example. And, you know, I might be, maybe I'm even feeling lonely now. Okay. And so when we look at the evidence against, you know, it might be, well, you know, I'm lonely because of the social anxiety, not so much because of whether or not I screw up a presentation or whether or not I'm cool. But I could probably meet friends that were, I would say, you know, we should look for kindred spirits. You know, oftentimes those of us who have a bit of social anxiety or worry about being around people or what they think of us is because we're trying to impress the wrong people instead of trying to see whether we click or fit with the right people. So, you know, if someone's judging you harshly or, you know, not very kind, then, you know, maybe they're just not the right people to be hanging out with. We should be looking for people who are kind and warm and welcoming and we feel good around. And so you can maybe even remember people who do support me, no matter what. And we can also look at other people, you know, look at, you know, if you're worried about how well you do, whether you blush in presentations or people think you're kind of awkward or not very skillful, then in this example, we might think of, you know, coworkers who aren't perfect at presenting. And do they get through? You know, most people are quite nervous about that. So this is sort of, made that big. There we go. There we go. I have to have one technical problem every every class. Okay, so if we go to the next step, so let's look actually at this worst, what would be your worst case scenario? And maybe it's completely messing up your presentation and screwing it up. So then what you want to do is look at how would I cope? Okay. Actually, maybe in this case, I'll even, how would I cope if I messed up the presentation? So I don't know, what would be like the worst presentation? You started crying in the middle of the presentation and turned beet red and forgot what you were going to say, and your technology screwed up in the middle of the presentation. So what you would do, well, how would I cope with that? You know, I could make a joke about it. I could take public speaking classes and work on my anxiety. Maybe join Toastmasters. Work on my anxiety. And have a chat with my boss. About sort of next steps or what else you could do. And then I could talk to other coworkers, ask them how they get through presentations. I mean, it's pretty hard to get through life without being embarrassed once or twice or 100 times, or I'm pretty klutzy. I do all kinds of things like walk into walls, trip, and I always kind of dread winter here and the ice and snow because I'm not really fast on my feet. So, you know, we don't really get through life without some sort of embarrassment. So, you know, those of us who cope well with embarrassment or have learned to cope well with embarrassment, it's usually by practicing, you know, using a little self-deprecating humor and carrying on. And then learning how to be comfortable. Like, it's okay to be a nervous person. You could tell yourself it's okay to be nervous during a presentation. You know, most of us are nervous during presentations. I give a lot of them, and still I'll get nervous from time to time when I work through presentations. So that's normal. That's nothing to try and get rid of. Like, I don't know how to do it. Or a lot of people ask me, well, how do I not feel nervous during an exam? You know, I see a lot of students who are going through exams, or even people who are running exams after graduation, if you're getting different kinds of certifications. And really, there's no way that I know of, you know, there's hardly a test that I've written where I haven't felt nervous, but I know it's okay to be nervous. And, you know, most of the time when I sit down to write an exam, I know that I can cope with those jitters in the beginning, and I try and focus on the questions, and eventually I usually get into it. But there's been the odd test where I've been nervous the whole way through, and that's okay. So once you think, like, if you think of nervousness or anxiety is bad, or it's going to affect your grade, then that can freeze you even more. That's even more pressure to make the anxiety go away. But if you know, well, you know, it's not convenient, it's not great, but most people write exams when they're feeling a bit anxious, or at least a bit of adrenaline or sleep deprivation. Nobody really writes exams under ideal conditions. So for any situation that you're worried about, whether it's a public speaking event or being graded or a job interview, you want to shift your thinking to, you know, well, you know, a job interview is another good example. You know, most people are nervous during job interviews. Most people have a lot of adrenaline when they go in. You know, one thing that you actually, if this is something I usually tell people who are nervous about their job interviews, is, you know, use that, say, I'm so excited to be here. You know, I really like this company, and I've followed you for a long time, and really happy to be here. And because that may be true, right? If that job is important, if you didn't care about the job, you wouldn't be that nervous about it. You know, if you're applying for a job that you really didn't want, then you don't have that adrenaline rush. So it's that same sort of thing. You want to look at how you would cope in that situation. And then you want to look at what will probably happen. So when, you know, we've got here, you know, the thought that you have, we've got the thought here, the prediction, you know, I'll be rejected and alone, evidence for and against that. Then you have your anxiety rated over here. And then how would I cope if I messed up? So we've got your worst case scenario here. I'm running out of room. You almost need like a full page of paper here when you're really going to challenge these kinds of thoughts. So the next part is, you know, what will probably happen? So let's go back to the example of a presentation that you're nervous about. Well, I'll feel nervous. I don't know why I'm putting a question mark there. So I might feel nervous. I might turn red. Have trouble finding some words. And I might forget what I'm going to say. At times, probably not the whole thing. And then, you know, but probably get through okay. I remember one time I had a professor this is just before I went to grad school, but he was talking about how he took this course on how to teach students. And in the first class, the person who was teaching them how to teach said, you know, what's the main thing that you want to accomplish when you're teaching? And everyone guessed, all these professors guessed at what it was supposed to be. And he said, well, no, you know, what you're really trying to do is just get through the hour and get through the class. And then you'll feel more comfortable and be able to talk on and on and on about it. So what usually happens is not our worst case scenario. Maybe we don't have the best performance of our lives, but, you know, it's probably going to be okay. And like anything, we're going to get better the more we practice. So this sort of leads us to our next thing, you know. So in this case, worrying probably doesn't help with this situation. This is the most probable situation. Best case is we just rock it and it's great. But there's a lot of factors that go into, you know, whether we pass an exam and whether we pass through a job interview or whether we do well on a presentation or anything that we worry about, whether we keep our job. It's not completely in our hands. You know, our job is to show up and do our best. But after that, there's other factors that play into it. You know, we're going to have a harder time giving a presentation if the audience is bored and don't want to be there. And we'll have an easier time if they're really happy and engaged and excited to be there. So it depends, you know, whether comedians know this too. You know, actually, you can think of what comedians have to go through because they bomb. They're not afraid to bomb. So that leads us to our next thing. You know, why do I want to face this fear? You know, I'm worried about taking this exam. I'm worried about doing this presentation. Why do I actually want to give the presentation in this example? So if you think of a comedian who has to stand up there in front of a tough crowd and lots of hecklers, really, really, you know, takes a lot of guts. And that's anxiety provoking. I don't think that there are many comedians who would say that they aren't nervous doing this sort of thing, but they get up anyway because the drive to perfect the craft and get better and better over time overrides the anxiety. So in this case, what overrides the anxiety for you if you want to get this presentation? So I want a promotion maybe. Right? It's part of my job. Whoops. Part of me thinks it's fun, you know. It's one of those paradoxes. Not everyone finds public speaking fun, but if you're a bit of an extrovert, a nervous extrovert, and you like being the center of attention, then, you know, maybe you really do want to get over this because there's a part of you that when you're on, you really, really love it and you love sharing information. And you want to change the world. Eventually, you want to be on TED. I don't know. Why not? You know, TED Talks. And so when you put all these reasons down, they have to be personal to you. You know, why do you want to do this? Why do you want to overcome this fear? You know, if it's a fear of flying, then you want to do it because you want to take your kids on a holiday. Whatever it is, you want to find this. I find so important, your own personal reasons for wanting to do this. If you can't find a lot of personal reasons for wanting to do this, if it's a list of shoulds, then maybe you need to rethink why you're doing it in the first place. I probably should do a whole episode on that. You know, knowing when your fear is telling you something's not right for you. You know, say you don't enjoy public speaking and you find it really draining. Even if you're not nervous about it, you find it really draining. Actually, I married someone who feels that way. He's not really nervous giving talks, but and he's okay and he likes talking some of the time, but it wouldn't be something that he'd want to do for a living. So in that case, you want to look, well, you know, is it right for me or is it not right for me? Because we all have our things that we really enjoy. You know, in university, when I was learning how to do career counseling, we did all these tests on ourselves, and a lot of my aptitudes showed that I should be an engineer. And I guess I inherited a lot of my dad's spatial skills. He's an engineer. I have zero interest. If I force myself to try and be an engineer, it would be really hard for me because honestly, like in high school, I tried to take physics and I fell asleep on my textbook. I'm not kidding. I could do it. I could not stay awake through it. So it's just my interest didn't match up with my abilities. So if I had tried to be something that I wasn't, then I would feel very, very anxious doing that. So that's something that you learn how to discern over time. But if you can come up with a lot of reasons why this would be really important, really good for you even, to not let fear stand in the way between you and a dream or a goal or something really cool, then it's much easier to work on the fear for one thing, and it leads to a much happier life. But even say, you know, physics I found really not that interesting to me, and lots of people can disagree with me on that. I never really got into it, but say it was part of my program, say I had to have a physics class to get my degree, well, I would do it then because I really wanted the degree. So you want to come up, so I'd want to jump through that hoop to get to where I wanted to go, and that would be the only reason. And then, you know, I would do my minimum and then move on to things that were more fun. But I hope that makes sense, so that, you know, even when there's some things we don't want to do, like I don't ever particularly want to clean my house or do the dishes, but I want a clean house. And so I have to find a way to get there, to get there, or, you know, a clean laundry too. You know, if you have loads and loads of laundry, like most of us with kids do, you don't particularly want to do it, but you also want to have clothes toward work or, you know, wear the next day. So you do it. In that case, you do it with at least acceptance. So that's what we're trying to do with this is, you know, think about what are some of the reasons, some of your motivation for actually wanting to do this. Why do I want to face this fear? And then what we want to do is come up with sort of a better feeling thought. I know this is kind of confusing. I'll kind of summarize in a second here. So what would feel better than it'd be awful if I screwed this up? You know, I'm going to put more peaceful. Because one thought's not necessarily better than the other, it's how it makes us feel. So if the thought that we had was originally, it would be awful. If I screwed this up. Okay, so it might be lots of, people feel nervous when giving presentations. And that's okay. If I practice, this is another thought, I should get better over time. Can use anxious energy to energize my presentation. But you see what I mean? You're going for a thought that makes you feel better. And, you know, if you tell yourself, well, it's actually okay to be nervous during a presentation, most people are. If you say work in a larger company or with other students who have to give presentations a lot of the time, you know, watch your colleagues, watch your classmates, and see, you know, that they're usually feeling nervous too, and that you'll start to gradually see that most people don't notice a lot of the signs of anxiety so much when we're in those situations. But you want a thought that's going to bring you a little bit more peace. So that's basically how we go about challenging these different thoughts. Oh, I just shrunk my screen again. There we go. And I made it too big again. But basically, that's how you go start to challenge your thoughts. So I know that's really kind of confusing here. What I'll do is I'll put together some sort of worksheet that you can use. There's lots of them out there, but I'll design one for you. But, you know, step one, you record the thought. Step two, you look at the prediction. I'm going to put thoughts here, so the chaining of thoughts. And here you look at the prediction, which is usually, you know, it will be awful. 3. You rate anxiety. And 4, you go back to the evidence for and against. In this case, the prediction. Okay, and then we look at how would I cope? With the worst case scenario or that prediction, and then try and 6, what will probably happen? And does worrying help? You can just ask yourself. The answer is always no, so that's a short one. And then your list of reasons why I want to do this. That's something you're doing. Okay? Why I want to work on this worry, why I want to overcome this worry. So that's a lot. We covered, so this is mostly challenging fears and how to look at evidence for it. And these are mostly for fears that we kind of believe. That I kind of believe that they're not good, that they're harmful, that they're problematic. And so we want to challenge that belief that that's really true. The short answer is really nothing that we think is true. We can always find evidence for and against any thought. Facts are different, right? You know, someone cuts you off in traffic, that's just a fact. But if you hate that they cut you off in traffic, then we can look at evidence for and against that thought, you know, and which thoughts are going to bring you peace. So that's a whole other thing. But what we're going to do in the next class is we're going to focus on letting go of thoughts that you already know are kind of silly, that you don't really believe, but you can't shake them. You know you shouldn't be worrying about them. You know that they're really improbable, but they're kind of stuck in your brain. So we're going to talk a little bit more about what's happening in the brain, why the brain does get stuck, and what we can do to shift gears, let go of those thoughts, how to work with our brains to develop a little bit more patience with them, as well as accepting uncertainty. We're going to spend a lot of time on uncertainty next class, and accepting the unacceptable in some cases, some things that we can't control. We'll spend a little bit of time talking about, you know, fear of illness, fear of death, those sorts of things, which are a big part of worry for everybody. I mean, who doesn't worry about dying? Maybe a few people, but I'm not one of them. So, but I can cope with that worry about it. So we're going to talk a little bit about that. So next week is more about letting go and acceptance. And have fun this week. See how many worries. Start practicing challenging your worries and see if you can punch some holes in some of the beliefs that you have. And you'll get better and better at it. So, you know, certainly keep some of those questions too. You can, we're going to have a live class for those of you who are watching this while the classes are coming out. And you can send me some of those worries for the class and we'll go through some of them. If you're watching this after those classes are over, you can watch the recordings of the live class and see some of the questions that come up. So most of us worry about the same things. So anyway, have a great week, and I'll see you next time. Take care.